Project Babylons, Project Loom, Leiden, Lilliput, Project Panama, Valhalla, short and sweet. Happy Gregorian New Year, everyone, and welcome to the Inside Java Newscast, where we cover recent, and in this case, future developments in the OpenJDK community. I'm Nicola Parlock, Java developer advocate at Oracle, and today we're going to talk about Java's plans for 2025, or more specifically, what the big OpenJDK projects, except Amber, will be working on this year.
Why except Amber, I cannot hear you ask? Because just like with the JDK 24 feature set, OpenJDK keeps being too productive for this show's format. Kinda disrespectful if you ask me. And so I have to make another two-parter, and Amber, plus a few miscellaneous developments that I'm aware of, will take up the whole second episode in 2 weeks.
Before we get started with this episode, I need to do a bit of housekeeping. I'll talk about what features these projects will work on this year, but that by no means implies that they are going to be released this year, so let's be patient. But if you want to speed things along, you actually can. Find a feature that interests you and is in some form of preview. Try it out in anger and give feedback, a bit more on the importance of that later. If you want to follow these developments along, make it a habit to check on inside.java where we publish updates as they appear. And of course, there are links to all projects, mailing lists, and everything I mentioned in the description. Ready? Then let's dive right in. Project Babylon's primary goal is to extend the reach of Java to foreign programming models such as SQL, differential programming, machine learning models, and GPUs. Babylon will achieve this with an enhancement to reflective programming in Java called Code Reflection. The Code Reflection prototype is available in the project's repo and is currently being carefully refactored to prepare for an eventual incubation. Its further development is mainly being pushed by the ongoing work on HAT, the Heterogeneous Accelerator Toolkit, which offers an ND range-based GPU program model with idioms that are familiar to GPU developers. Babylon is also exploring an ONNX script equivalent, of course in Java, at this point mostly just to prove that it can be done. And I heard rumors that there's a chance, no promise, that project lead Paul Sandoz can present a prototype at Java 1 in March.
Alright, did I tell you that Java 1 is back? Again?
Redwood Shores in the Bay Area, USA, March 18th to 20th. Meet Paul, Brian Getz, and many other OpenJDK leads and contributors. Tickets still available, link in the description. Code Reflection, HAT, ONNX, all of this is still pretty early though. If you want to get a better understanding of the current state, I link two fairly recent emails with progress reports in the description. You can also check out these three talks from the JVM Language Summit in August 2024. Paul presents an update on Code Reflection and another on HAT, including a live demo of computing the game of life on a GPU. Very courageous. Intel's Steve Dorman presented on how to translate Java to Spiro V. There are also some articles, including one about neural networks with Triton, and another about emulating C-sharp's Link, again both from Java of course. Lots going on in Babylon, the tower is getting taller. After finalizing virtual threads in 2023, Project Loom removed the biggest hurdle to straightforward adoption in 2024, pinning of virtual threads when interacting with object monitors, which means no more pinning on synchronized blocks and on object wait. This will be shipped with JDK 24 in March. The highest priority for 2025 is progress and hopefully finalization of the two preview APIs Loom has in the fire. Structured concurrency, for a simplified concurrent programming model that treats groups of related tasks running in different threads as a single unit of work, for a host of benefits over other threading models. And scoped values, which can be summarized as an improved and more virtual thread-friendly variant of thread locals. The team is still looking for more feedback on these, particularly on the structured concurrency API, which will in all likelihood see a slight revamp in the next preview in JDK 25. If you have the chance, please try these APIs and report back to the Loom mailing list. Java developers frequently ask me how they can contribute back to OpenJDK. And while most are thinking about writing code, an easier and much more valuable way to contribute is this: trying out previews in as close to a production environment as possible and reporting the results back to the respective projects. Every project lead I talked to for this video asked me to ask you for more feedback. To put it bluntly, what makes your contribution unique isn't that you can code, the OpenJDK folks are kinda decent at that. It's that you can report real-life outcomes of putting new features into practice. That's much harder to achieve for OpenJDK in a matter that represents all niches of Java's gigantic ecosystem. Beyond the structured concurrency and scoped value APIs, there's also work on less impactful pinning issues and lock information in thread dumps.
Feels like only yesterday that we watched Project Leiden gurgle its first word. It was Condenser, by the way.
And in just 2 months, we can already use its first feature in production, namely ahead of time class loading and linking.
Growing up so fast.
Again, if you have the chance, please kick the tires and report back, particularly your experience with training runs.
As for 2025, there are two features in the pipeline that will be worked on, namely ahead of time method profiling and code compilation. Very early JEP drafts exist for both, and I can't wait for them to stabilize. Once that happens, we'll of course take a closer look at it here. Project Lilliput aims to reduce the memory consumption of object headers by shrinking them from 12 or 16 bytes on 64-bit systems to 8 bytes with a stretch goal of just 4 bytes, which would free up 10 to 20% of the heap. JDK 24 will ship with experimental compact object headers of 8 bytes that you can put through the ringer and report your findings. The main task for 2025 is to evaluate in practice the performance as well as the imposed limit on the number of classes. This limit stems from the fact that each object header contains a so-called class pointer, which references a data structure describing the object's type, for example, its field layout. With fewer header bits, that pointer had to shrink to 22 bits, meaning a maximum of 4 million classes. Sounds plenty, but keep in mind that some libraries and frameworks generate classes at runtime, which may make some applications surpass that limit. Beyond that, there are also some implementation details to iron out. The goal of all this work is to make compact object headers non-experimental and eventually the default. Project Panama has three irons in the fire. First, the Vector API. It's very stable for now and some projects already use it in production, but its finalization is still waiting for Valhalla. You might have heard me say that it's waiting for universal generics specifically, but it looks like I was wrong about that. Instead, it's about identity and specification. It's important for the API's performance that vectors lack identity, which is currently achieved by bespoke optimizations in Hotspot, but without value types, this behavior is unspecified. So once Valhalla's JEP 401 starts the preview on value types, the Vector API can lean on that and itself go from incubating to preview, which will include a thorough re-review of the API that may result in further changes. If you've used it and found some operations missing or any other issues with it, please take it to the Panama mailing list. Second, the foreign function memory API was finalized in JDK 22 and has been very well received. Since then, the project's focus has shifted to improving performance, specifically by making memory access as fast as possible across the board and by reducing the startup and warm-up time from the use of method and variable handles. They're also working on record mappers, which allow user-friendly and performant mapping between native memory segments and Java abstractions such as records and interfaces. The core functionality is coming along well, and various ways to express it are currently being explored. And third, there's JExtract, the tool that generates FFM bindings from native library headers. The main focus there is to try and take advantage of the stable value API to emit simpler bindings with fewer side classes. Stable values are still in development and don't technically live under Panama's roof, but they visit often to hang out with their cool aunt. I'll get to stable values in the next video. Before going into the tech, we need to talk about the Valhalla when comments that pop up under every video on this topic and quite a few others. Love them. Keep them coming. Every time I see one, I forward it to Brian, and I'm really happy that German labor laws protect me. Okay, so Project Valhalla, short and sweet. First, JEP 401's value types preview has become the tip of the spear, and the main focus is on getting it out to you. Second, a somewhat surprising runner-up is the development of null check types like string bang and string question mark, also sometimes called emotional types, presumably not because they make people emotional, even though they definitely do. Check out this talk by Brian to learn more about that. The link in the description is timestamped to the respective chapter. And third, some early explorations of improved numerics and primitives layered on top of value classes. That leaves us with only one question. Valhalla